I'm very aware we've just eaten lunch. We've already heard a lot of information. So I am going to share someone, open the word, and consider some things in regard to friendship there. But then my hope is to allow plenty of time for us to do some Q&A. So follow those instructions on the app and start sending questions in whenever you want. And we can do a good bit of that as well. I trust there'll be a lot of different conversations or just questions about how do we pursue ministry friendships and how do we do so in a way that makes them beneficial. So we definitely will get to that. If you take your Bible, though, and turn to 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 23. As you're doing that, I'm assuming like a lot of you, Spurgeon is a hero of mine and appreciate his ministry so much. I've learned so much from just studying his life, as I know many of you have. But one of the things that I enjoy about Spurgeon are the things that are they're kind of less known about his life. So many of us love his preaching, his wit, his humor, his courage, you know, his boldness, his faithfulness in the midst of a lot of personal trials as well as difficulties in his life. But I find that there are two aspects of Spurgeon's life that are lesser known that I appreciate the most about him. One is that when he was a very young pastor, he did something very few pastors would do, and that was during the plagues, the plague in London, where a lot of people were fleeing the city. Spurgeon actually, in his early 20s, canceled speaking engagements that he had in his early 20s because he was sought after preacher even as a young man to go and minister to the sick and the dying through the plague in the cities or in the city of London. And I've always appreciated how much Spurgeon did that and focused and was willing to go in with a lot of courage and a lot of risk to care for the sick and the dying. That's not the stories you hear about Spurgeon much, but I appreciate that about him. Another aspect of his life that is lesser known is his friendships that he had with some other pastors. And, you know, he was uniquely transparent about his struggles with depression and those kinds of things. But Spurgeon had some very close friendships that he leaned on in a lot of different ways. And Ian Murray wrote a biography on Spurgeon's eventual successor. His name's Archibald Brown. And Banner Truth published this book. It's still one of my favorite biographies I've ever read. It's about Archibald Brown and how he succeeded Spurgeon at the Met-Tap. But Brown pastored another large church on the other side of London during Spurgeon's ministry there. And there are a few books that just capture beautifully the sweet friendship that was between Brown and Spurgeon. In fact, this biography, it's about Brown and his life and his ministry. There's only one chapter that highlights his friendship with Spurgeon. And it's an incredible chapter. It's worth the value of the book to even just read about their kind of friendship that they had. Let me read a couple of excerpts for you on this. Brown had lost he had lost two wives within 10 years. And upon the death of his second wife, Brown later wrote about Spurgeon's care of him during his grief. Here's what Brown wrote, according to Murray. "Broken with sore grief, I went over to the Metropolitan Tabernacle. I could not preach, but I thought I could worship, and how amazed I was to find that he had prepared a sermon on purpose for me. As I turned around to come out at the close of the service, there was just one grip of his hand as he said, 'I have done all I can for you, my poor fellow.' I felt he had. I rode home with him that day and had his loving fellowship as he sat with me during the afternoon." And years later, Spurgeon's just a few weeks from dying, he pens this final letter to Archibald Brown. This is what Spurgeon wrote in that letter. "Beloved brother, receive the assurance of my heart love, although you need no such assurance from me. You have long been my most dear to me. But in your standing shoulder to shoulder with me in protest against deadly error, we have become more than ever one. The Lord sustain, comfort, perfect you. Debtors to free and sovereign grace, we will together sing to our redeeming Lord, world without end. That was a few weeks before Spurgeon died, and it was the last letter that Brown received. And upon the news that Spurgeon had died, reached Brown in London a day after his death. Brown, his next sermon on Sunday at his church, he actually emotionally spoke about his dear friend Spurgeon once he recently went to glory. Here's what Brown said in that sermon about Spurgeon. He has been to me a very Elijah. I have loved in any way possible to minister to him. Our roots have been intertwined for 30 years. Is it any wonder that I feel almost powerless this morning to think of him as a preacher, as an orator, as an organizer, or as anything except the dearest friend I have ever known? So Spurgeon and Brown, they were spiritual giants in their day, tempted to probably be in a bunch of comparisons, pastoring the two large churches in London at that time. And yet they knew what all of us, I think, know. And that is the need for close, personal, intimate, sacrificial, pastor-to-pastor, ministry-leader-to-ministry-leader type friendships that would regularly turn us to Jesus and to support one another in that. And that's the same thing each of us need, regardless on what kind of ministry we lead. And as a ministry leader or pastor or lay elder, oftentimes it's hard to find those friendships because of the nature of the work that we do. So at first, before we dig into 1 Samuel 23 as the example I'd like to look to in regard to understanding maybe God's plan for us and needing friendship in this way, here's the need I want to articulate to you. We need close, honest, transparent, and safe ministry friendships. Close, honest, transparent, and safe ministry friendships. Notice each one of those words is chosen carefully. Close, honest, transparent, safe. Safe is an important word as we think about a friendship that benefits us as ministry leaders. And I want to give you just a basic definition. What is friendship? What is friendship as we talk about this? Friendship is an intimate relationship of love, trust, and loyalty. It's an intimate relationship of love, trust, and loyalty. Every modern ministry leader needs the presence and friendship of other ministry leaders, I believe, to be able to thrive in our work and to be able to persevere throughout the unique challenges that ministry brings us. And I think the best place to start, where God maybe demonstrates how he used strategic, meaningful, even providential friendships in the lives of his key leaders throughout Israel. And I want to look at the example of David and Jonathan and their friendship that we find in 1 Samuel chapter 23. Now I'm going to read verses 1 through 18, if you'll follow along with me. And then we're going to look at this passage in closer detail and see this example. Now, I want to just preface, I know this is Old Testament. You know, this is the monarch of Israel. Saul is on the throne at this time, and he's trying to kill David. And that's the context that we find this in. So I'm very aware that this is not the New Testament. This is not an example in the early church, but I do believe there are some principles here that can help us try to find the friendships that we need, because we see how God uses the friendship of David and Jonathan at a key time as leaders within the house of Israel. And I think there's some crossover there for us. 1 Samuel 23, I'm going to start at verse 1, and I'm going to read through verse 18 if you'll follow along with me. When David was told, "Look, the Philistines are fighting against Keilah and are looting the threshing floors," he inquired of the Lord, saying, "Shall I go and attack these Philistines?" The Lord answered him, "Go attack the Philistines and save Keilah." But David's men said to him, Here in Judah, we are afraid. How much more then if we go to Keilah against the Philistine forces? Once again, David inquired of the Lord, and the Lord answered him, go down to Keilah, for I am going to give the Philistines into your hand. So David and his men went to Keilah, fought the Philistines, and carried off their livestock. He inflicted heavy losses on the Philistines and saved the people of Keilah. Now Abathar, the son of Ahimelech, had brought the ephod down with him when he fled to David at Keilah. Saul was told that David had gone to Keilah, and he said, God has delivered him into my hands, for David has imprisoned himself by entering a town with gates and bars. And Saul called up all his forces for battle to go down to Keilah to besiege David and his men. And when David learned that Saul was plotting against him, he said to Abathar, the priest, bring the ephod. And David said, Lord God of Israel, your servant has heard definitely that Saul plans to come to Keilah and destroy the town on account of me. Will the citizens of Keilah surrender me to him? Will Saul come down as your servant has heard? Lord God of Israel, tell your servant. And the Lord said, he will. Again, David asked, will the citizens of Keilah surrender me and my men to Saul? And the Lord said, they will. So David and his men, about 600 in number, left Keilah and kept moving from place to place. And when Saul was told that David had escaped from Keilah, he did not go there. David stayed in the wilderness strongholds in the hills of the desert of Zeph. Day after day, Saul searched for him, but God did not give David into his hands. And while David was at Horish in the desert of Ziph, he learned that Saul had come out to take his life. And Saul's son Jonathan went to David at Horish and helped him find strength in God. Don't be afraid, he said. My father Saul will not lay a hand on you. You will be king over Israel, and I will be second to you. Even my father Saul knows this. The two of them made a covenant before the Lord, and then Jonathan went home, but David remained at Horish. So this background of this passage, these first 14 verses kind of give us some of the detail around that. Saul is he's chasing David to kill him. Saul's the king, and David is fleeing from Saul. And in the midst of that, David goes to defeat the Philistines in Keilah at the God's hand. So in the first five verses, David goes and defeats the Philistines on behalf of the people of Keilah to save them, to rescue them. But then Saul finds out David's there, and he pursues David. And then David is betrayed by those in Keilah to help Saul. We see that, look down in verses 10 and 12. He sees betrayed, and God reveals this to David, so he's able to flee and get away. And David flees, and God continues to protect him. This is what we see. Look down in verse 14. We see that God protected David and did not give him over to Saul's hands. But we need to assume something just because God is revealing to David what's happening, he's able to flee. We still need to assume as we watch David run for his life. Verse 14 says, every single day Saul sought after him to kill him. We need to assume David is weary and he's afraid and he's even maybe doubting what God is doing. And this sounds like the needed grounds for a well-timed friend to show up for David. And that's what we see Jonathan do. Notice in verse 15, we see that happen. So I want to look at two aspects to this passage. Three reasons ministry leaders need friendship. That's the first thing I want us to see. Three reasons ministry leaders need friendship. And then I want us to look at the benefits of friendship for ministry leaders. So the need and then the benefits. And we find both of these in this passage. So first, the needs. What's the needs for friendship? Three reasons. Number one, ministry leaders need friendship. Number one, because leaders inevitably experience opposition. Because leaders inevitably experience opposition. I once heard someone say wisely, if you want everyone to like you, then you probably shouldn't lead. And I think that's true for all of us. However, in light of this passage, the king pursuing to kill you is probably on another level of opposition that we have not experienced. The king's hatred of David, it led to the army's hostility toward David, and they were all trying to kill him. And verse 14 says that every single day Saul sought David to kill him. Why do ministry leaders need friendship? I think leaders need friendship because sometimes we just need to know that someone's actually for us in the middle of maybe a lot of people that feel against us. Leaders will inevitably experience opposition. It's inevitable. Why are we surprised at it? It's part of the design. But also part of God's design, I believe, to help us persevere in that is that friendships provide the safety, the support, the security that we need as we face the opposition we have. It's amazing when I talk to pastors who are facing a lot of opposition, and it's really having an incredible toll on them. And at some point I'll ask them, so do you have anybody to talk to in your life about that? And oftentimes they say no. That's why they reached out to me. And that's usually one of the signs on why they're struggling so much. It's not necessarily the opposition. It's facing that kind of opposition in the midst of feeling very lonely and isolated. And so that's why ministry leaders need friendship. Leaders inevitably will experience opposition. We have to have the support in the face of that opposition. Number two, second reason ministry leaders need friendship because, number two, leaders will experience betrayal. Leaders will experience betrayal. I remember in the early years of my ministry, and we were going through those difficult times, I was reading through slowly, just drinking it in, so I was reading it slow. I'm not a fast reader either. The autobiography of Spurgeon, that four-volume set, and that his wife and his assistant put together. And I remember reading at some point when Spurgeon says, "Now when your brother betrays you," and I'm like 30 years old and just these couple years into the ministry, and I had faced the opposition already, but it was people who obviously were against me from the beginning. And I remember reading that, thinking to my young self, oh, Spurgeon, he had gotten so cynical by then. You know, what do you mean when your brother, don't you mean if your brother betrays you? And then he went on to say what he said. And I thought, man, that's too bad. He's already jaded by this time and just can't even, didn't realize that doesn't have to happen. It just does sometimes. Within 2 months, I went through one of the most painful betrayals still to this day I ever experienced by one of my young pastoral proteges in the ministry. It was in our church training for ministry, and he betrayed me in a very significant way. Very painful betrayal. It's not if, is it? If when we lead, betrayal is going to happen. And we need friendship for leaders in ministry because we will experience betrayal. David, notice, defeats the Philistines to save the people of Keilah. And you know what the people of Keilah do to say, thank you, David, for going and defeating the Philistines and saving us? He betrays him to Saul and tells him that he's there. So even though God shows David, hey, Saul's coming, you need to leave again. Imagine what David went through, the hurt he felt, the betrayal he felt. He had gone to rescue the people, and that was how they rewarded him. We need friendship because leaders will experience betrayal. And don't miss the parallels of this of being a pastor. Because the reality is, it's often the sheep that we seek to care for that bite us somehow. And I know what a lonely place that is. And some of you know what a lonely place that is. And you might ask, what's the solution to it? I think part of the solution is that we surround ourselves with meaningful friendships in the ministry to help us through those times. Number three, third reason ministry leaders need friendship. Number three, because leaders are tempted to doubt God in suffering. Leaders are tempted to doubt God in suffering. Now, the Lord kindly protects David in all this. We see this, but don't miss how this would affect David in his humanity. I think we read stories like this and we think, man, David's got this direct line to God. He's telling him what to do. He's telling him where to go and what to do it. I'm sure he's doing great. He knows God's with him and he's talking to him. I think that's naive. I think David's humanity would still kick in despite the fact that God is with him and showing him where to go and telling him what is going on. I think David's humanity is kicking in here and being on the run for his life from the king every day is going to make him weary. It's going to make him lonely. And just like us, it's going to make him doubt what he knows to be true. One of my mentors shared with me, never doubt in the dark what you know to be true in the light. But when we're in the dark, it's hard to believe those things sometimes that we know is true in the light. I think we need to give credit that that's probably what David was feeling. And aren't we too tempted to doubt God? Something we maybe knew for sure in the light. When it gets dark and suffering comes, we start to doubt. Does God really know what he's doing? In fact, think of David. God says, he's coming. You need to flee again. And even though God told him, would we not be David and thinking, God, what? Do I have to be on the run like this every day? Are you sure you know what you're doing? I think we need to assume that David would have some doubts in his weariness, in his fear. So ministry leaders need friendship because we're tempted to doubt God when suffering comes. I assume we all can relate to that. I know we wished we would all, our faith would soar when we face the deepest suffering. And that can happen at different times. We also know that's not the case, don't we? When suffering comes, sometimes it challenges our faith more than anything to try to understand. So that's the need. It's a need for friendship that we see in the context of this story. But what I want to do is turn to verses 15 to 18 and see that ministry leaders benefit from friendship. There are six benefits I want to give you. I'll go through them briefly. But you'd be encouraged to write these down. And again, feel free to start sending questions on the app because we're going to get to that in a few moments. But what are the benefits of friendship? If we need friendship uniquely as leaders, in the same way as leaders as David and Jonathan were, they needed support from one another. They needed friendship. So do we. And I think there are six benefits between the relationship of David and Jonathan that we see in verses 15 to 18 that are the same benefits we all need at ministry friendships today. I think you'll see the crossover with this. So I want to read verses 15 to 18 again, and let's remind us what the interaction between David and Jonathan is actually like. Look at verse 15. While David was in Horesh in the desert of Zeph, he learned that Saul had come out to take his life, and Saul's son Jonathan went to David in Horesh and helped him find strength in God. Don't be afraid, he said. My father Saul will not lay a hand on you. You will be king over Israel, and I will be second to you. Even my father Saul knows this. The two of them made a covenant before the Lord, and then Jonathan went home, but David remained at Horesh. Six benefits that we find in this passage, okay? Number one, presence. Presence. Look at verse 15 and 16. There's an important thing that happened here that will teach us a lot about friendship. Verse 16, and Saul's son, Jonathan, went to David at Horesh. He went to him. He found David, and he took the risk to go and see David where he was. This is pointing to the ministry of presence that's so valuable that we don't give a lot of credit to. Sometimes we try to be more helpful by just talking. And what if we could be most helpful to someone in friendship by simply just being present with them? Can you imagine what that would be like? Can you imagine the fear David felt, the doubt he felt? He's hiding out in some cave somewhere, and all of a sudden, he turns and he looks, and he sees the silhouette of Jonathan coming through the entrance. Can you imagine what that did to David, to see his friend Jonathan come in? And Jonathan hadn't said anything yet, but could you imagine what that meant to him, what that did for David in that moment? We underestimate the power of presence. Don't miss the power in that gesture. Don't miss how some of us just need someone who will come and sit with us and may not even say anything. Is that not the best way often to care for grieving people in the ministry? To not come in and have a bunch of words to try to fix the situation or make it better? Sometimes pain and loss is just pain and loss. And we need somebody to just come sit with us and say, I'm sorry, and I'm with you. And that's what Jonathan's doing with this gesture he makes. As he goes, don't forget, Jonathan is Saul's son, whom Saul is looking for David to kill him, and his army is. And the risk for Jonathan to go and go find David and go to him, all to care for his friend. Ministry of presence, that's number one. Presence is one of the main benefits of friendship for us. Number two, strength. Strength. Look at verse 16. And Saul's son, Jonathan, went to David at Horesh and helped him find strength in God. Now, this can mean a lot of things. We don't know exactly what he's talking about, but strength was given to him. We certainly can assume that his presence was the starting place on where that strength came from. But it says it strengthened him in God. He found strength in God through his friend who came to see him. Don't miss that on how much friendship can actually strengthen our hand in God because of something that they would come alongside and do for us. And notice he hadn't said anything yet. And yet there's these two benefits. Power of presence. Number three, comfort. Another ministry benefit of friendship is comfort. Verse 17, Jonathan does speak. Notice the first thing he says. He says, don't be afraid. Now, what this should tell us is either Jonathan, in seeing his friend, saw fear in David, which, by the way, I assume all of us would be afraid at that moment, knowing the king every day is seeking to kill us. But he sees fear in him, or maybe he also just assumes, because he's human and Jonathan can relate, that he's afraid. But then Jonathan says to him, don't be afraid. There's power in those words. In a sense, he's saying, don't be afraid. I'm here, and God is with you too. Because can he really say that? Don't be afraid. My next words would be, have you heard your dad's trying to kill me? I have reason to be afraid. But yet Jonathan says, don't be afraid. Why? What is he saying to him? He's comforting him by, I'm here, and God's with you. And that he's to be comforted in that moment. Sometimes a ministry friend can come along and say something we know and we've heard a million times, but we've forgotten because we doubt God in suffering. And a friend can come along and simply say the right words to remind us what is true. And that's what he does here. And it's a comfort to him. Number four, protection. Protection. Jonathan continues. He says, don't be afraid, verse 17. And he said, my father Saul will not lay a hand on you. Now, with all due respect, Jonathan is not in any position to say Saul's not going to hurt him. Saul and his army, in fact, are looking for David. What is he saying here? Why is he saying this? How can he say, my father said, will not harm you? Verse 17 specifically says, he will not lay a hand on you. How is he able to say this? Well, he can't prevent Saul and his army from harming David. That's the reality of it. But what is Jonathan doing in here that we can learn from? Jonathan is declaring that he intends to protect David at all costs. It's as if Jonathan is saying to David, if my dad's going to get you, which I can't prevent, but if my dad's going to get you, he's going to have to come through me to get you. You know, sometimes we need a friend that comes alongside us and just says that. Look, I can't keep these people from coming after you, but just know they're going to have to come through me before they get to you. Sometimes we just need somebody to be with us like that. In the height of the hostility I was dealing with in years 2, 3, and 4 at the church, I mentioned I had an associate pastor who came with me, and he didn't get paid. He just came to help, and had already had a career. He was in his 40s, but feeling a later call in the ministry. His name was Mike, and Mike came to the church to just help and to learn because he wanted to go into the ministry at some point. By the way, he got quite an education those first 5 years. But we had a routine when it got really bad that Mike would meet me at one of the side doors on Sunday morning when I would come to church every Sunday morning. This went on for about 2 years, off and on. But in the height of the fights and the conflict, there would be people waiting for me to come in to kind of pounce and attack for something they wanted to argue with me about it or fight about. And they were waiting for me to walk in the building to do it. So Mike and I would make a plan on which door he was going to meet me at when I would enter the church. And he had one job, and that was he was to escort me to my office, get me there, escort me to the service so I could preach and get through the service before I had to deal with all of those things. And it helped that Mike was like 6'5 and 300 pounds, by the way. Now, I can't tell you what that meant to me that I had somebody with me. I can't tell you. I don't believe I make it through those years without him. He and his wife and he had 3 daughters, and they were there. They cared for us in a way that there's no way we make it through those years without them. And Mike could not prevent the people to come at me. But in a sense, that's what he was saying. I can't keep them from coming, but I'll tell you, I'll get you to your office. Like, they're going to have to come through me to get to you. I'll get you to the service so you can preach and minister before. Yeah, they'll have to come through me. And I felt that security and that safety with his help. Matter of fact, it was interesting. At the end of those 5 years, Mike, God called him to go be a full-time pastor somewhere at a church, so we sent him there. And I can remember the Sunday, that the first Sunday Mike wasn't there. And all those hostilities had gone, but it was just kind of this moment of fear I felt because I had grown to feel the comfort of his security, of his safety and his presence that I didn't have anymore. I still remember the palpable fear I felt walking down the hallways, even though I didn't have anything to fear at that point. Sometimes we just need somebody to come alongside. I'm with you. I'm for you. And yeah, they're going to have to come through me if they're going to get to you. That's what David declared. And he's talking about his own father. So protection. Number 5, providence. The 5th benefit of ministry friendships is providence. Look what else he says. Still at verse 17. Don't be afraid. My father will not lay a hand on you. Then he says, you will be king over Israel, and I will be second to you. And even my father knows this. What is Jonathan doing here? Well, he is reminding David of God's plan for his life. Did you know that God had already told David he was going to be king? He knew that was part of what God had promised him. Something that potentially he was doubting in the midst of all of this. And by the way, Saul is the king. Do you know who the rightful heir to the throne is? Jonathan, his son. So for Jonathan to not just say, remember what God said, you will be king over Israel and I'll be second to you. He's not just saying, I'll be with you. He's saying, the spot that's mine is yours because God's declared that's what's supposed to happen. And I will be at your right hand supporting you in it. Imagine how David felt knowing that's how Jonathan felt. But Jonathan is reminding David of the providence of God. This is what God's promised. And though you may be doubting, and though you may be weary and tired and your doubts are coming from the suffering, God's plan for you hasn't changed. I think that's something important probably for all of us to hear. Do you know the reason God called you wherever you are? The reason God sent you there? The reason you felt called to go there? That hasn't changed. Now, the circumstances maybe have changed. You probably know a bit more about how hard it is where you are. But in the providence of God, God still placed you where he wants you until he shows you where you're to go next. And sometimes we need a friend to come along and say that very thing. Did God make a mistake? Is this not where you're supposed to be? Or maybe is this an ordained suffering in the plan and providence of God that he is still with you and has not changed? That's really in essence what Jonathan's saying to David here. You will be king over Israel. That has not changed. Can we all just acknowledge, if we were David, that'd be a pretty strong doubt that could enter into our mind, wouldn't we say? That, okay, I know God said this. The current king is trying to kill me, so I can't be king at all. And by the way, I'm on the run every single day of my life, hiding in caves. Not necessarily the life of the king, of being a king I'm supposed to be. I think it'd be an easy way for us to doubt if we're in that position. But providence is a benefit of ministry friendship. Sometimes a ministry friend who knows us and loves us and is for us knows to sit with us and say nothing and knows when to look at us and go, you know God is still at work. He's at work in you and through you, even though you have a hard time seeing that. Last one, number six, the sixth benefit, promise. The benefit of ministry friendship we see is promise. Verse 18, after Jonathan said this to David, the two of them made a covenant before the Lord. And then Jonathan went home, but David remained at Horesh. It says Jonathan and David made a covenant before the Lord. Remember what a covenant is? It's a promise. It's an agreement between two people before God, and it's sealed by blood. And this is the promise between them. It's binding. And it's based on the words that Jonathan just spoke to David. Think about what he just said to him. You'll be king, I will be second to you, and I will be with you. And my father knows this. This is the will of God that will happen in your life. And this is my commitment to you to see it through. And they make a promise together based on that. It's a promise Jonathan made to David as a friend to always be for you and I'll be with you. And if you have anybody in your life that makes a promise like that, you're blessed. Imagine a ministry friendship that is committed to help you with that. A pastor down the road, a ministry leader in your community, that says, if you need me, I'm there. We talked about friendship a little bit in the track I was doing earlier. And here's the example I like to give. Like, I have a short list of the pastors I'm to call to bail me out of jail. That hasn't happened, by the way. Who am I going to call if I'm at the lowest point and my life's a mess? Who do I know? Come bail me out of jail. And I thankfully have some friends like that. Hopefully never have to call them that way, but they're there if I need them. Who's that for you? Who do you have that person? You're like, man, my life gets so messy. Who do I call for help? David had that with Jonathan. Though this is Jonathan caring for David, I think we can assume there is a mutuality in the love and the commitment that they have for each other, which is also built on that covenant promise that's just made. So that's the six benefits. There's a need for friendship, and there's the six benefits. And I think there's plenty of crossover, I hope you see, in it. So the last couple minutes before we go into Q&A, so send those questions into your app. And we're going to get to them in just a couple minutes. I want to get kind of a modern-day practicality about this. What does this look like for us, a friendship like this? These are principles from the Old Testament in the life of Israel. But obviously, these are principles. They stop at a certain point. We could obviously look at many New Testament examples of friendship. Especially with Paul and Timothy to start there, as well as others. But I want to give you five kind of practical ways. How does a modern ministry leader find these needed friendships? How do you find them? And I'm going to give you these five. I'll be brief, and then we can flesh more of this out in the Q&A in a few moments. So feel free to ask questions around this. Five practicalities, okay? Number one, you have to die to self. You have to die to self. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean, you will not find meaningful, safe ministry friendships if you don't sacrifice in some way to find them. The pushback I get on a talk like this from pastors is, yeah, you're going to add one more thing to my list? I got to go find a friend now? Well, yes. Because I don't know a shortcut to find that kind of relationship. You got to invest in it. However, I'm very aware that we don't just have all kinds of time to go find a bunch of friendships. So that's what I mean. You got to die to self, but you got to be creative in how you do it. There are ways for you to sacrifice to a friend that you want to build a friendship and relationship with in a way that doesn't necessarily have to take a lot of time. But if we get creative and thoughtful about how to do that, there's plenty of ways to do it. Here's one example. One of my dearest friends, Jim, those who listen to the podcast, this is Jim Sebastio, who I do the podcast with, our ministry. And Jim has been a pastor for almost 40 years, planted and pastored the same church for 33 years now. One of my dearest friends, and he found out that my youngest daughter, Claire, and he shared the same birthday, January 17th. And he just kind of stumbled on that. And a few months later, it was January the 17th. And I'm at my house. I hadn't left yet. And all of a sudden, Jim pulls up to my house. And I look out the window and I see Jim coming to my house. He typically doesn't come to my house. I thought, what's he doing here? And he comes up to the door and he's carrying this box of gigantic cupcakes. There's a place back home called Gigi's Cupcakes. Looks similar to some of the amazing pastries I've seen in stores around here. But we're Americans, so, you know, we kick it up a notch. And so, like, they're almost little cakes. But we call them cupcakes, yeah. So he had a box of six of these cupcakes. It's a legendary place. Everybody in our city loves them. And he brings this box, and it's for my daughter, Claire, for her birthday. She was 5 years old at the time when he shows up in my house with cupcakes. And of course, I open the door, let him in, and I call Claire in, and she walks in and sees Pastor Jim, and he's got cupcakes for her, and he says, hey, I'm your birthday buddy. Happy birthday. Hands her the cupcakes, and you can imagine the five-year-old response to this. She couldn't believe it. And he says to her, now these are yours because it's your birthday. If you want to share them with your siblings, you can. If you don't, you don't have to. That's up to you. And she took the box with this glee in her face. And she was so impacted by that. But you know who else was impacted by that? It was me. I mean, who does that? I remember he lives all the way across town. He probably drove 40 minutes in the middle of rush hour traffic to come to my house that morning. On his birthday, by the way. And I remember it walking away. I had tears in my eyes. And I just thought, who does this? This is a man who's got his own church, his own family, and his own birthday to celebrate. And yet, how thoughtful was that? And Jim did that for 10 straight years after that. My daughter turned 15. She looked at me and she said, so I think we need to take cupcakes to Pastor Jim. I said, I think that's a great idea. We showed up at church on a Wednesday night. He wasn't expecting us on their birthday and took him cupcakes. That didn't take a lot of time, but can you just sympathize with me on how thoughtful that was, how creative that was? What did he do there? I mean, he did it to encourage my daughter, but you all know this. One of the ways to love your friends is love their kids well, love their spouse well. That's what Jim did. Die to self. We have to sacrifice to communicate and build those relationships. But we got to find creative ways to do it because we've got limited time, but that doesn't mean we can't do it. Number two, value the power of presence. I kind of talked about that already, so I don't want to spend a lot of time there, but I just want to reiterate that. Find a friend that maybe just needs you to sit with them. I have a friend like this. His name's Rob. We meet a couple times a month now, and we meet on Wednesday morning, same time, and we do the same thing every time. We sit across from each other after we've gotten a cup of coffee, sitting at a cafe, and we just look at each other and say, what do you need to say? What do you need from me? And all we do is share, unload, whatever it is we need to say. And the other one just sits there and doesn't respond, just sits there. Just exercising that value of presence. Did you know most of our conversations, we're talking to somebody and we're not fully listening because we're thinking about how to respond to them? The value of presence means I can sit there and I don't have to worry about, I don't have to respond to you. I can just kind of hold this space for you and say what you need to say to another human being, which by the way, is what we need oftentimes. And I sit across from a table with Rob a couple times a month and we just value each other's presence. And when we get done sharing whatever we share, all we do is look at each other and say, thanks for sharing that. I love you and I'm with you. And that's it. Value the power of presence. Number three, seek friendships inside and outside your church. Seek friendships inside and outside your church. If you have meaningful friendships in your church and you are a ministry leader in your church, God bless you. That is a wonderful gift. That is also rare. Most pastors and ministry leaders have a hard time finding friendships in our churches. Doesn't mean we shouldn't try. That's why I say it needs to be inside and outside the church. But oftentimes, the safer friendships we find are going to be with other pastors and ministry leaders outside of our own church context. It's just there's a level of safety there. There's a level of somebody to be able to relate to what we are going through because they are a fellow ministry leader. And you never know where those friendships are going to show up. So sometimes we need friendships inside and outside our churches. And sometimes those relationships outside the churches may not even be with other ministry leaders. It might be specifically somebody who's not a ministry leader. I hit a point about 5 years ago, that was something that I actually needed and I didn't realize. See, I had a church that wanted me to be their pastor. And then I had this growing ministry of a bunch of pastors wanting me to be their pastor. And all of a sudden I woke up one day and realized just about everybody in my life wants me to be their pastor. And I hit a horrible place of loneliness and isolation when I felt like there was nobody in my life that just wanted me because it's me, not because of maybe what they need from me. And I think a lot of pastors, ministry leaders who pour out all the time feel that way too. So I found a friend who's not a pastor, not even part of the same kind of church, different kind of church. And he doesn't even want to talk ministry. He wants to watch sports and eat wings. And I'm like, that's what I needed right there. You know, I just needed a friendship that was different than most of the other relationships. And that was a very valuable thing. Look for them inside and outside your church. Number four, last two. Then we're going to questions. Number four, pray for each other. Pray for each other. Do not underestimate the power of just being a friend that reaches out and prays for each other. I have a friend of mine. He's a pastor about 2 hours away from me. He's in his mid-60s. You've never heard of him. Pastor's a church same size as your all's churches. And every month he calls me for one reason, just calls me to pray for me. He sets it up every month, calls me to pray for me over the phone. And I can't see him, but I know this is his practice. And he asks me different areas of my life, checks in with me about areas he can pray. And then he prays, and this man, 65-year-old man, he gets on his knees and he weeps when he prays for me. And that's all he does. And then he stops praying, and then I pray for him. And then we say goodbye. That happens once a month. Now, I'll let you imagine how meaningful that is to me personally, that I have a friend that he's not asking for anything. He just wants to call and pray for me. We all need friends like that. Don't underestimate how much just praying. Like, think of a friend that you could just call. I don't need anything from you. God had put you on my heart. Can I take a moment to just pray for you? Just give me about 4 or 5 minutes and we can just pray. Be that friend to somebody else and find that friend if you're able. Last one, number five, don't give up. There's some practical advice. Don't give up. Why do I say that? All it takes is for a friend to hurt you, a ministry friendship to go bad, someone to hurt you in the church and make things really difficult for you in the church, to where you're going to say, okay, that's the last time I'm doing that. I don't need any more trouble. And we just give up on trying to find friendships. My final encouragement is just don't give up. This is something I believe every single one of us needs if we want to thrive in our ministry and if we want to do it a long time. Okay, I'm going to stop there. I'm going to invite Graham to come up. See what kind of questions, and continue to send those in if you'd like. Thanks, Graham.
Great. Thank you very much, Brian. Now, we have one small issue is we encourage you to start sending questions in early. And I've been tracking. Well done. And some of them Brian's then answered later on. We didn't know you were going to get to the practical stuff at the end. So what I'm probably going to do is probably take a few of those. I'm going to sort of blend some things together. I hope I'll cover the different things you've sent in. We've got a few questions, Brian, kind of where you ended. We just want to give you a chance to say a little bit more. So things like how we can organically deepen existing friendships, or how we can find, make, and sustain, or what regular patterns would be beneficial for deepening and maintaining friendships. So maybe let's just begin with, I'm a pastor somewhere. I don't currently feel like I've got any friends. Where might I start? What would I do first?
Yeah, okay. So the first thing I would say is be realistic. If you want to have 8 friendships that you're going to just invest in, I don't know many people who have that much time. So I would say start with one.
Yeah.
Like start with one, the one you really believe in that you think could be what you need and that they what they would need, and there'd be mutual benefit from that. And I would just start trying to invest there. And by the way, be honest with them. I mean, set terms with them. Let them know, hey, I'm looking for someone. I just want to build a friendship with somebody who understands what it's like to be a ministry leader or whatever the context. But I don't have anybody in my church to talk to and lean on. And I would love if maybe we could mutually help each other in those kinds of ways. Just be upfront with what you're looking for, and begin to try. I mean, honesty is really a good thing that helps cut through some of the, let's read the situation and all. Just be honest. The second thing I would say is, especially some of you who are in, you know, remote villages, there's maybe not a lot of pastors around you that, even though you've tried, you need to take full advantage of technology. And continue to invest in friendships that you already have. So I'll have pastors reach out to me and they're burnt out, they're discouraged, they're about ready to walk away. And I'll ask, do you have anybody you can turn to there locally in friendship that you could talk to? And they'll say no. And my next question is, okay, tell me your closest friend that you have on this planet right now. It doesn't matter where they live. And a lot of times they'll say, well, it's this friend that, you know, that I had from my university days, or it was this friend, I stay in touch with them, or whoever it might be. And then I encourage them, then reach out to them. Take advantage of FaceTime and Zoom and all the technologies that we had that we didn't have at one time that really can help us stay connected to other people. So, excuse me, build on the relationships that already exist that kind of represent what you would like to find in a local context or maybe in a ministry context, but you don't have it yet. Start there. And I mean, literally, I've reach out to them and say, hey, here's my situation. Would you be willing to connect with me maybe a little more regularly in this way? Here's kind of what I'm just feeling like the Lord's leading me that I need. And you never know. They can say no, be prepared for that. But you might be surprised on how much maybe they're looking for the same thing but didn't know how to find it. So that's kind of the low-hanging fruit, I believe. But then it's a matter of just continuing to try to build relationships with people and find it.
Yeah, thank you. And I think I'd emphasize in our context, I think it's quite un-British to basically say to somebody, could you please be my friend? We tend to think there's got to be another reason for meeting.
Yeah.
Rather than that openness of, I could really do with someone just to walk with. Could we meet regularly, share and pray with each other?
Yeah.
And I've certainly had that with a couple of people. And it's like, oh yeah, let's do that.
Yeah.
But that's not that. So I'd encourage you. Be un-British in that way.
Well, and let me add this too. Like, yeah, how you have that conversation matters. Like, I'm an American, but if somebody comes to me and say, will you be my friend? That pretty sounds pretty sad. So I don't do that, okay? But yeah, the way you articulated it, Graham, is good. It's hey, I'm looking for somebody to just walk through things. Would you be willing to kind of do those kinds of things? Yeah. But even if it's more countercultural, I would say that even more of a reason to do it, to be un-British, yep, if that's the case, that because then you're going to communicate that much clearer what your intentions are and why you need it. Those terms are going to be set pretty clearly because it's not normal.
Yeah. Okay. We've got quite a few here, so let's try and speed up if we can. Okay. But let me just there's a couple of things on. So if we're in a friendship, but we want it to go deeper, we want to go further, we want to maintain it. Any quick things on how we get better?
Yeah.
Once we're up and running,
I think it depends on what you need to be able to know what it means to go deeper. First of all, if you just know you want to go deeper, but you don't know exactly what that means, you're going to have a hard time even helping that person figure out what that is. So first, identify what does it mean to go deeper. I want to talk about more personal things, or I want us to deal with this kind of stuff, or whatever it might be. So you actually have to have an awareness of what that is. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to help guide it. Which is the second thing I'd say is, if you want it to go deeper, you have to begin to kind of nudge it along. So for one example, if you want to go, I want us to be a bit more vulnerable in our conversations. We're kind of chit-chatty about surfacey stuff. Let's talk about some of the things we're struggling more with. Well, instead of just saying, hey, would you just share a little bit more personally than you do? You're really shallow. Just be the first one to say, you know what? I'd like to share some with you. It's a little more personal. That'd be okay. And you model by example. I think that's how you naturally, organically go deeper.
Yeah, thank you. One specific, just on that same area of making and sustaining, but specifically for women in ministry, someone asking, given the lower number of women that there tend to be in ministry, mm-hmm, how can they find, maintain meaningful friendships and so on of these sorts? Anything specifically? I take it what we've just said will be true as well for women.
Yeah.
But anything specifically you'd say on that?
No, I'm glad you asked that. Whoever asked that, I'm glad you asked that, because it makes it that much harder if there's less to potentially pull from. However, it's kind of like buying a house. All it takes is the right one to find what you want. But it's also why I'm so thankful for the way that the FIEC has organized women in ministry, ministry workers, to kind of come together in different ways. So I would say if it's the kind of friendships or the kind of role that's not as well known or just not as many, it's not that you have to work harder. I think you just have to be more strategic about it. So go to, you know, when there's the opportunities to go to a gathering of ministry leaders in your context, like make the time to go do that. When the FIEC offers a Zoom call for, you know, women's workers, get on those calls, like find ways to be a part of those circles. And then that's the way the organic relationships come together, which is ultimately what you want. You don't want to try too hard with this, but you do have to give the time, and then you have to put yourself in the position to find some of those relationships.
Yeah, thank you. I just add for anybody, maybe if you're like a lead pastor somewhere, you have, say, a women's worker or someone on your staff like that, to talk to them about that. Encourage them in that. Give them permission to take the afternoon to drive to the next town or whatever it is once a month to spend time with someone else. So help them in that.
Yeah, one of the things, as our ministry's grown a lot, one of the things we've tried to do is kind of build this informal network, a relational network. So when guys reach out to us, not only do we try to help them, but then we actually say, okay, there's somebody an hour from you. You didn't know this, but they're with us and I'm going to connect you. And I know the FIEC has that desire to want to connect people. So take advantage of their service and their massive network of people.
Now, you commented a little bit on this before, but you got a lot of votes. So do you want to say anything else on this? Benefits from seeking ministry friendships within the church versus outside the church. Within the church, of course, could also include specifically within the elders.
Yeah.
Or from outside. You commented on that briefly. Anything to add?
Yeah, just as a realist, when you're the pastor of the church, it's hard to find friendships in the church because you never know for sure. Is this person really just want to be my friend, or do they want to be close to the pastor for some reason? And that creates a natural cynicism, maybe suspicion, and it makes it hard to find friendships. So I would say if you have a church that has elders or a team of leaders, I do think that is the best opportunity to build friendships within the church. I had close friends in our church at different times and seasons of ministry, but most of them all came from when we moved to elders, and I had elders because they're in the same boat with me. We need to have the same conversations. We need to carry the same level of confidentiality because of ministry. And when somebody's not in that role in your church, it's not the same thing. So that doesn't mean we can't have friendships within the church. We just got to have realistic expectations, which leads me to this. You can have friendships in the church, but it doesn't mean that you don't have to find your best friend in your church. There was a guy in my church. We were friends. We literally got together and watched football games and ate wings and hung out together and kind of had some spiritual conversation at times. But he didn't like to have a lot of spiritual conversation. He liked to talk about other things. And I enjoyed that relationship. It had limits, but it was somebody in the church. I just enjoyed his company. And so you can have differing levels of expectations.
Thank you. And following on from that, is another one, a lot of sort of upvoting. Within the friendships within the church, is there a risk in church members seeing you get on particularly well with certain friends? And this, of course, is where there's a certain chemistry to friendship as well as the openness and safety we've talked about.
Yeah.
Could it be viewed as favoritism, extra power, influence? What would you say?
Yeah, well, the answer is yes. Yeah, it can be viewed as that. So I think you have to be mindful of that. I think every situation is different. So I'll reference my friend Jim again, because he planted a church. He's been the pastor there for 33 years. He's absolutely beloved by his church. And he has church members that go on holiday with him every year. It's like a tradition they've had for 30 years. It's one of his elders, but there's church members he actually takes on holiday with him. Now, I would probably normally not recommend that for the obvious reasons, but they've been doing that the entire existence of the church. So it almost feels like it's not something that someone would be able to accuse because that's gone on for so long. So I think we have to be mindful of it, but I think there's a balance. I think it's also important for ministry leaders to have friendships within the church. I think we need to be mindful of the perception, but I think we can go too far in worrying about what everybody's thinking, and we just do what we need to do in the midst of having a meaningful friendship. Last thing I'll say is, it's one thing to go on holiday with somebody, and it's one thing to like take pictures at Disney World and put them on Facebook together. It's another thing to have them over for dinner regularly, and maybe not many people know that people are coming to your house or something. You're not publicizing it to everybody. There's differing levels of people to even find out. How much do you spend time with other folks? So I think that's something to keep in mind.
Thank you. Continuing on that vein, really, I guess we're thinking here probably of a non-elder friend. How can we share transparently and honestly with that friend about our struggles in the church, maybe our struggles with sin, and that be kind of safe for them and for us? How transparent are we with someone? I'm assuming here that within the eldership, we'd be pretty transparent about that. But outside the eldership, what does that look like?
Well, I'll first say, in light of that, I think it's ideal if we can be transparent about that in the eldership. I think that's more, it's common that we can't.
Yeah.
Just depends on the situation. That would be, but it is ideal for sure. But as far as outside the church, yeah, I think that's one of the motivations to find friendships outside of your church. Because if you can't have relationships in your church with that kind of transparency, it's just the reality, depending on what kind of church situation you're in, to find somebody outside the church is going to be safer simply because, one, you're not their pastor. Two, they're not a fellow elder. And three, they're out of the circle of just social circle of church life and things. We can probably feel a bit more safe to be honest and open and transparent in that kind of relationship. But again, it's got to be a trusted person. I will add in the midst of this, I believe that pastors and ministry leaders, we should all get counseling at some point. So I'll just drop that bomb and we'll leave it. But the reason I say that is, by the way, I've been going to a counselor off and on for the last decade. And I had some marriage struggles 10 years ago that God really used a counselor to really help us. But then I'm really thriving in my life by God's grace. I have no crisis. And I still, once a month, drive 1 hour each way to go visit a counselor in person that I meet with and drive home an hour each way. I do that because this is a relationship that feels totally safe to me. And even the professional relationship I have with this person as a counselor, they're bound to confidentiality. I really can talk about whatever I need to talk about and get some help, even if other relationships don't feel safe. Well, think about finding someone like that to be able to talk to as well.
Yeah, thank you. This is a little more off topic, but it's got the most votes, so I wanted to include it. And maybe we'll expand it slightly. Would you comment on the pastor's spouse when he is being attacked and betrayed, and how we can serve our wounded spouses? So I guess there's an issue there for like friendships for spouses in ministry.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's particularly an issue of support for spouses when their husband's getting attacked.
Yeah.
And it seems to me there's the issue they have knowledge but no power.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not a happy combination.
Yeah, whoever asked that question, thank you. So for pastors' wives in the room, I want to share with you, as a pastor who was pretty viciously attacked for several years in the early years of our church, I learned that as hard as that was for me, there is one more difficult place to be than me in that, and that was my wife. So pastors' wives in the room, you have the hardest job, I just want to say. And what I have found is the reason that is because if I get attacked as a pastor, I can fight back if I want. I mean, I can choose to do that and reap the consequences of whatever that is. I have yet to ever witness a pastor's wife who goes and fights for her husband in the church, and that goes well. And y'all know that, don't you? Which is why you know you have to sit back and watch it happen and pray and try to support your husband and try to figure out how you even emotionally just deal with it yourself. I just want, ladies, that is the hardest position in these churches. So just know that. And I think that God sees that and knows that. Having said that, it means that you definitely need the support of others to help walk through that. And it definitely needs to be friendships outside of your church. And I think the best place to find that is other pastors' wives who know that unique spot. This is literally the hardest position to be in when my husband's being attacked. to find another pastor's wife who can relate to that, have somebody to talk to, and develop a friendship. I think that can be one of the sweetest friendships and relationships that you can find. But that's obviously hard to find. You've got to work hard to figure out how you're going to meet that pastor's wife. But I want to encourage you to try to find that and to try to develop that kind of relationship, because you need it more than anybody.
And again, the FIEC would love to help with those connections. Yeah. That can happen kind of organically. We have our Pastor's Wives Conference, which can be a great place just to start to meet others as well. We just got 2 minutes, so maybe just one quick one and then I'll pray.
Okay.
Which one shall I pick? I'm going down the list. How can we be a good ministry friend to others in such a way that their dependence remains ultimately in God, not in the comfort and security we give?
Yeah, good question.
You've got 1 minute.
1 minute. I would say that finding the balance, and part of this is getting to know your friend, but the balance of, does my friend in this moment need me to just sit here and do what Romans says? We rejoice with those who rejoice. We weep with those who weep. That's a formula that Paul gives us when he writes to the Romans. And I think it's something we should embrace, in that just being present with another person can be all they need. But like David, like Jonathan did with David, there's a time to also read, is this a moment where I need to remind them that God's with them, that God sees all that's happening, and that I trust that God's goodness in this, I trust he'll use it for your good. We have to find the balance in when to be silent and just love people and empathize, and when do we need to speak truth, biblical truth, to help encourage someone. And a lot of times that's what we need. This model is so helpful because Jonathan did both of those in the same meeting. So finding the balance of that, I think, is key.
Great. Thank you so much.
Yep.
Thank you, Brian. Let's pray together. Mm-hmm. Father, we thank you for the many friends and those you put around us who sustain and strengthen us, and those whom we can strengthen. I want to think particularly of those who feel they need that more, those who lack that right now, and ask in your kindness over the weeks and months to come, you would help them take appropriate steps and you would give them the gift of good friends. And we pray each of us would then be friends to others around us, supporting, pointing people to you, helping each other find strength in God in all of the ups and downs and battles and joys of ministry. We look to you in this. We ask you would kindly sustain us through this gift. And we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.